But, you know, Elijah saw a storm like that, and he thought, okay, God's going to be coming here, and nothing. And he experienced all of these different weather phenomena, expecting the Lord to show up. And then when the Lord came, he came with a still, small voice. And in this process, in our study about living and walking in the kingdom of the heavens, part of what God wants us to learn to do is to hear the still small voice. Because most frequently in our circumstance in our life now, God doesn't come generally with the booming voice. He generally comes with the still small voice to see if we're listening. Because when it comes to the kingdom of the heavens, it's whosoever is willing may come. We have to choose to be willing to listen and to come. And that's where the Lord has us. We've been looking at Solomon, and we've been talking about discernment in the kingdom of the heavens. And what do you recall from last week that you saw that we were looking at? Well, I want to know about roofing work at my house. There you go. Okay. The experience last week that we were looking at about King Saul, you'll recall that the people were demanding a king. And, you know, we talked about the fact that the descendants of Israel wanted a king because it was too much work when there was a problem not to have someone that would already have figured out an organization to take care of all the problems. You see, prior to that, when there was a problem like there was with the Midianites, the people would begin to cry out to God saying, God, you know, they come and steal all of our crops after we've raised them and harvested them and maybe even gone them through the threshing and we've done all the work, and then they come and steal it from us. And so they prayed and said, God, please deliver us from the Midianites. And we read just, 2 weeks ago, about how God went out and Gideon was chosen. You remember the experience? And we know that this is Jesus. Before he was Jesus of Nazareth, he was God the Son, appeared to him, because he worshipped him and actually brought a sacrifice and an offering to him. So that's how we know that it was God the Son prior to his incarnation here in the world. And Jesus said to him, the Lord said to him, hail, valiant warrior, the Lord's with you. And you remember that we saw that Gideon was a man with discernment. And he said, if the Lord's with us, then why is all this happening to us? We raise the crops, we do all the work, and then the Midianites come and they steal it all from us. And because they rule over us, we can't even have a sword to protect ourselves. We even have to go to them to get our axes sharpened and our hoes sharpened. We're not allowed to have a blacksmith. And so the Lord said, I've selected you. He said, oh, no, not me, God. But the Lord said, oh, no, I've selected you. But you see, that's what they used to have to do when there was a problem. They didn't want, it was too much work. They said, so God, what we want to do is we want to have a king like all the other nations have. And they kept saying, and God said, now here are the reasons why. He sent Samuel, told them, here's the reason you don't want a king. And they said, we want one anyway. God says, okay, here you go. Have a heap and help it. And of course, we saw last week, and we were looking in 1 Samuel. Do you remember there we saw about a man named Kish, who was devoted to the Lord, and he had a son named Saul. But you remember that the donkeys ran away. They got out of their pen. I didn't look today, tonight. Were the donkeys in their pen tonight?
Oh, right.
That's good.
They're looking for you.
They're looking. But there were three. It's interesting. There were three donkeys that had gotten away, and he sent his son, and they kept going to all these places. And then ultimately, he winds up, before it's all over, being anointed as king. And the people all gathered together, and they began to cast lots, and it fell down to the tribe of Benjamin and to Kish's household. And then Saul was acknowledged before the gathering of all the leaders of Israel. And do you remember what kind of a demeanor that Saul had at that point? Do you remember, we just read this last week, but a lot of things have happened since then. Yeah, he was meek and he was humble. In fact, when the meeting's going on, he was hiding among the bags. He was over in the baggage. And they finally had to send someone and bring him. And when he appeared, oh my goodness, was he impressive. The Bible says that he was head and shoulders taller than anyone else. He looked like a king. The people were all happy about it. So we read some of the experiences that were going on in Kish's household, which are not unlike experiences, day-to-day experiences that we have in our life. And so Saul has been anointed as king. And we saw, as Saul had prophesied, Saul was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he started prophesying. And Samuel had told Saul, when you leave here, the Spirit of God's going to come on you and you're going to be changed into another man. And he's with the prophet. So here he is, full of the Holy Spirit, and he's prophesying. And the power of God was on him by the Holy Spirit. And then, of course, shortly after that, he's anointed as king. Well, they go back, everybody goes back to their household. And that was in 1 Samuel chapter 10. If you'd like to look there on your list, if you still have your blue sheet from last week, 1 Samuel 10 is where we saw all of this transpiring. Oh, but by the way, there were some guys who didn't, they looked at him and said, yeah, this guy, he has no experience as a general. He's not been in battle with us. In verse 27 of 1 Samuel 10, it says, but certain worthless men said, how can this one deliver us? And they despised him and didn't bring him any present, but he kept silent. See, at that point, he was not so full of himself that he was going to run out and try to take revenge or vengeance on these people who were reluctant to acknowledge him. And then we saw in 1 Samuel 11, over here in this community of Jabesh-Gilead, that the enemies came in, and the Ammonites, so you got the Amorites, but you also have the Ammonites, and this is the Ammonites. They came and took their town, and they besieged it. They weren't allowing any traffic to come or go, and so their food supply would be getting short and so forth. And verse 2 of 1 Samuel 11 says, now Nahash the Ammonite said to them, I'll make it. He said that they wanted to make an agreement with him, and he said, we'll serve you. And they said, well, I'll make it on one condition, that I gouge out the right eye of every one of you. I want to make all of you a reproach to Israel. Now, it's interesting to me why he would choose specifically that, gouging out a right eye. It's very symbolic. The Bible talks about God saying that my right eye will guide you in the way you should go. And he's talking about the Holy Spirit guide. So there was a lot of symbolism that's included in this. But on top of that, the descendants of Israel had learned one of the Hebrew names for God means healer. And when they would get sick, they would pray. They had the advantage over anybody else. They would pray and cry out to God, and God would heal them. They were very healthy people. So here's a double insult to gouge out the right eye of, was it just the men or was everyone in the community? He said every one of you. It may have just been the leaders. And so the elders of Jabesh said, well, leave us alone 7 days. So they sent messengers. And in verse 6, the Spirit of God came upon Saul mightily when he heard these words, and he became very angry. This was not a fleshly outburst of anger. I have been known to have fleshly outbursts of anger. I know you're amazed to hear that, aren't you? We're not supposed to talk about that when we're together for Bible study or church, right? Because everything's wonderful, peachy keen, never had a ding problem in the world. Phony baloney. That's what the religion has taught us to do instead of being honest with each other. I've been known to have outbursts of anger. This was not a fleshly outburst of anger. It's the kind of anger that Jesus had when he went into the temple and he saw the religious leaders had set up a system. They were actually cheating God's people. Because if you lived up in Dan or up in the Golan Heights and you had to travel to Jerusalem, you couldn't hop the bus. You couldn't even get on a motorboat, row across the Sea of Galilee, cross the Jordan, and go down there at Jericho. You went on foot. And so you would take your offering you were bringing to the Lord at a festive time, you would sell it, and then you'd bring that money down, and then you would buy a replacement for that sacrifice. And the money changers moved right into the temple. And they were notorious for having dishonest scales and cheating people. And when Jesus went in and saw what was going on, he didn't just explode with anger. He went out and he got some leather, and he got probably not just those cords, but he found a branch or a stick, and he made a whip, and he went in and he took the whip and he flipped the tables over and he drove the money changers out of the temple. And he said, "My God's house is to be a house of prayer, and you've made it a den of thieves and a den of robbers." He was so angry. That's the kind of indignation that King Saul has right here. He's filled with the Holy Spirit when he heard the words, and he's angry, and he took this oxen and sent the pieces all throughout the country and said, "Everybody better send their warriors down here. We got to go rescue our brothers over here at Jabesh Gilead." And so, and it says that the dread, in the end of verse 7, the dread of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out as one man. They were unified, one purpose, one mind. "We have to defend our brothers down here. We're not going to let their right eyes be gouged out by these Ammonites." And so in verse 8 it says, "He numbered them in Bezek, and the number of Israel were 300,000, and the men of Judah 30,000. You remember Judah primarily was two tribes, and then you have 10 tribes that made up Israel, and so there was a larger area and a number of other tribes there. And so they said to the messengers, "Go deliver this message at Jabesh Gilead." Well, King Saul shows up with his men and surprises them, and it happened the next morning in verse 11, this is still 1 Samuel 11, that Saul put the men in three companies. Hey, he had some organizational skills. He had a plan. Where do you suppose he got that from? It doesn't say that he had a whole bunch of military experience. That's why a bunch of people said, "This guy can't be our leader." And he figured out, and the Holy Spirit and the Lord guided him, three companies, and they struck down the Ammonites until the heat of the day, and it came about those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together. And in verse 12, "Then the people said to Saul, 'Who is he that said, shall Saul reign over us? Bring those guys here. We're going to kill these guys that spoke ill of Saul being our leader.'" But he stopped them. And he said, verse 13, "Not a man shall be put to death this day, for today the Lord has accomplished deliverance. It's a day of celebration, rejoicing. No one's going to be executed for their sin and their lack of support today." And Samuel said to the people, verse 14, "Come, let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom there." And so they went to Gilgal before the king. Now, in chapter 12, verse 1, Samuel said to Israel, "Behold, I listened to your voice and all you said to me, and I have appointed a king over you. Now here is the king walking before you, but I am old and gray." His hair didn't all fall out. Maybe he's talking about his beard. Okay. And he said, "Behold, my sons are with you, and I've walked before you from my youth to now, and I'll bear witness against me." And he actually says, "Have I cheated anybody? Anybody has aught against me? I want it brought out publicly right now, because I'm up in years and my time here in this world is not too long." And of course, no one had anything. But jump down then to verse 12. And he said, "When you saw that Naash, the king of the sons of Ammon, came against you, you said to me, 'No, but we'll have a king reign over us.'" So he's rehearsing with them, reminding them of some of the history and the things that had just happened. And he said, "You wanted a king," verse 12, "although the Lord your God was your king. Now therefore, here's the king whom you have chosen, whom you've asked for, and behold, the Lord has set a king over you." And in verse 14, "And if you'll fear the Lord and serve the Lord and listen to his voice and not rebel against the command of the Lord, then both you and also the king who reigns over you will follow the Lord your God." By the way, I think that still applies to America today. Because this is repeated in Scripture, that if the people fear the Lord and serve Him, the rulers over them will. And if the rulers over us don't, it's a result of the actions and our own conduct. And in verse 15, "And if you'll not listen to the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the command, and the hand of the Lord will be against you, as it was against your fathers. Verse 16, even now take your stand and see this great thing which the Lord will do before your eyes. Verse 17, is it not the wheat harvest today? I will call to the Lord that he may send thunder and rain. And then you'll know and you'll see your wickedness is great. Now, harvest time is not, I'm not experienced and knowledgeable about farming, but when you're harvesting, you don't want rain. Is that pretty much correct? Okay. The farmer back there is giving the thumbs up. You don't, even if you're harvesting alfalfa, you don't want rain on it, because then you bale it up and it grows mold. So now, mold I know a few things about, since we're in the business of mold remediation, among other things. But he says, I'm going to ask God to send thunder and rain, even though it's harvest time, and it's going to be judgment on you for your wickedness. And it's great. He says, your wickedness is great, which you've done in the sight of the Lord by asking for yourselves a king. So the Lord called, the Samuel called to the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day, and all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel. You know what's interesting? Jesus said, if you abide in me, and my words abide in, remain in you, then you're truly disciples of mine. By the way, he didn't say if you go to church every week. He didn't say if you pray every day. He didn't say if you tithe. He didn't say if you bring offering. He didn't say, you know, if you go on missions trips. He said, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you're truly disciples of mine, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free, and whatever you ask in my name, I'll do. Samuel prayed that it would rain at a time of harvest when they didn't want it to rain and when it normally didn't rain. And it rained. You know why? Because Samuel was living in the kingdom of the heavens right here on the earth. Just as Jesus desires that we live in the kingdom. And in this case, he was doing it as a sign and as judgment on them for their ungodliness. And demanding a king when God already had a plan worked out, but they weren't happy about it. Is that reminiscent of their forefathers? We don't like this what's it stuff, manna. You know, we think of manna as being bread, but it actually means what's it. This heavenly food, we're sick of eating this heavenly food every day. We want some meat. So God says, okay, he sends the quail in. And the quail fall on the ground and they got to have some meat. Well, they're like, God, it's been great. You deliver us with a judge every time. But we're tired of that. We don't like the responsibility. Here's what they said now. You'll understand this. We want to outsource that responsibility to someone else. That's why we want a king like everybody else has. Interesting, isn't it? Because that is outsourcing.
Yeah.
The original outsourcers going on right here. Hold on right here. By the way, don't be too condemning of them, because most of us have outsourced a lot of things in our lives. Like responsibility for our own spiritual well-being. Oh, no, that's why we pay the preacher. You go check with God. I'll come once a week and listen to what you have to say. We'll put some money in the offering. You keep checking with God. I'm going to outsource my responsibility. Now it's going to depend on you telling me the truth. And that's why a lot of people are in a heap of trouble in America today, because they've outsourced that responsibility. My personal opinion, now I want to give you, this is an opinion alert, okay? My personal opinion is that most Americans have outsourced responsibility for their physical health to others also. And I really don't believe that's where God wants us to be living. And there's a problem. He doesn't want us first to run to medicine. Now, Rick, are you saying you can't go to doctor? Look, I'm not your Lord, okay? I want to remind you of that. I don't even want to be your teacher. I want Jesus to be your teacher by the anointing, by the Holy Spirit, from the Word of God. So you have to make that judgment. If your natural reaction is, the first time you're feeling something physically, to run to the medicine cabinet, I can tell you for certain, this isn't just an opinion. It's all over the Bible. God wants us to check with Him first. Because He wants us to rely on Him. But most Americans and even most American Christians have outsourced responsibility to the experts about spiritual things and about physical things. In America today, there is no such thing as common sense. Because common sense and experience as an educator has been thrown away. And it really started in a big way in the 60s, and I remember enough of those days to have recognized that. Never trust anybody over 30. We're all out of luck in here. Some of us are double that.
Amen.
But you see, throughout all human history, it has been acknowledged that years of experience produce wisdom. And America doesn't acknowledge that anymore. We want a supposed scientific study to tell us everything. That's why your government spent several hundred thousand dollars to do research to see how alcohol affects young men in relation to their sexual activity. Do they get into more trouble than that? We can't get wisdom from somebody who's lived a little while. We need to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars so that an expert can tell us the facts. You see, part of what is going on about that is because our society is beginning to believe this thing that there is no such thing as wisdom gained from experience. We have to have proof. And it's infected everything, including the religious writings in America. That's why you know that most Bible study guides, very few of them ever get around to teaching the power of the Scripture, because they've been told we can't know any right or wrong, we can't know any real truth or untruth, there is no light and darkness, it's all just relative. And so most Bible studies are relegated to just teaching history. And when Jesus came along, the same kind of thing had been happening. And you recall what they said about the teaching of Jesus? They said, he doesn't teach like the Pharisees do. Dull and boring. The kind of teaching I have done in the past. Dull and boring. He teaches with power. And Paul came along and he said, my words and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and power of God. In preacher school, they taught us how to teach in persuasive words of wisdom. There was never any discussion of power. If there was at all, it was to tell us all that stopped after the original 12 disciples of Jesus and apostles had passed. And so the same problem is regenerating itself over and over and over again. These people had outsourced responsibility. They wanted it outsourced to the king. And Samuel said it really wasn't good. Verse 20 said, do not fear. You have committed all this evil, yet do not turn aside from following the Lord, but serve Him with all your heart. It's interesting that in Samuel's day, God was interested in people's hearts. Isn't that a bizarre thing? Today, God's only interested in your money and your presence, being in attendance at a meeting. Back here, He wanted people's hearts. Huh? And you must not turn aside, for then you would go after futile things which cannot profit or deliver because they're futile. For the Lord will not abandon His people on account of His great name, because the Lord has been pleased to make you a people for Himself. Moreover, as for me, verse 23, you're going to like this, you're going to recognize this, you may not have known this is where it was happening. Far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you. But I will instruct you in the good and the right way. Many of you know that verse of Scripture. You may not have known the context. The context was that there was going to be judgment on the people for demanding a king, but God gave them what they wanted. even though that was not God's will. Was it God's will for Israel to have a king? No, it was not. He wanted to be their king, but they weren't satisfied with that arrangement, so he gave them what they wanted. Now, what about you and me when we start demanding things, or the church in America today, when we start making demands of God, God, this is the way we want you to do things. God goes, there you go. But it's not my will, and you're left to your own devices. That's right. You're going to find out soon enough. Far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you. Famous verse quoted from Samuel here, 1 Samuel 12:23. But I will instruct you in the good and right way. Only fear the Lord and serve Him in truth with all your heart. For consider what great things He's done for you. But if you will still do wickedly, both you and your king shall be swept away. Now in chapter 13 it tells us, Saul was 40 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 32 years over Israel. And look what he did. He starts putting together his team. 3,000 men of Israel, of which 2,000 were with Saul and Michmash in the hill country of Bethel, while 1,000 were with Jonathan at Gibeah of Benjamin. And he sent the rest of the people away, each to their house. And in verse 3 it says, and Jonathan smote the garrison of the Philistines that was in Geba, and the Philistines heard of it. Then Saul blew the trumpet throughout the land, saying, let the Hebrews hear, verse 4, and all Israel heard the news that Saul had smitten the garrison of the Philistines, and also that Israel had become odious to the Philistines. They were beginning to be a little obnoxious. You know, they didn't have much power. They didn't have a standing army. They thought they could always handle them, and now they're becoming a little odious. They're becoming a bit irritating to the Philistines. And the people were summoned to Saul at Gilgal. Now the Philistines assembled to fight with Israel. 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, people like the sand which is on the shore in abundance. And they came up and camped at Michmash, east of Beth-Aven. And when the men of Israel saw they were in the strait, for the people were hard-pressed, then the people hid themselves in caves and thickets and cliffs and cellars and pits. And some of the Hebrews crossed the Jordan into the land of Gad and Gilead. But as for Saul, he was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him, trembling. Well, 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, they had nothing like that. And in verse 8 it says, he waited 7 days according to the appointed time set by Saul. You'd have to backtrack a little more to last week. Saul told him, go and wait. Wait 7 days. I'll get to you before you go to battle with these people. Samuel didn't come. He was delaying, and the people were scattering from him. In verse 9, so Saul said, bring to me the burnt offering and the peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offerings, and it came about as soon as he had finished offering the burnt offering, that behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to meet him and to greet him. Now, you see, it was not permissible. It was required that the priest offer the sacrifice. They knew the proper method in order to honor God's directions about how to bring the sacrifices. And verse 11, and Samuel said, what have you done? He said, because I saw the people were scattering from me, and that you did not come within the appointed days, and the Philistines were assembling at Michmash. And therefore I said, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not asked the favor of the Lord. So I forced myself and offered the burnt offering. And Samuel said to Saul, you have acted foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which He commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now your kingdom shall not endure. The Lord has sought out for Himself a man after His own heart, and the Lord has appointed him as a ruler over His people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you. You go, whoa, wait a minute. All he did was preside over the ceremony. No, wait a minute, you need to understand. There was a whole lot more going on than that. God had given the king instructions through Samuel. He said, wait for me 7 days, I'll be there. All these people came together. They're ready to go to battle. And some of the people got tired of waiting and started drifting away. And what does it tell you about Saul's heart when he gets in a panic? Because that's what he did, is he panicked. I was afraid that all the people were going to leave. And so I forced myself to do that. No, I acted out of fear. I did not have confidence that God would send the prophet here to bless us so we could go into battle with God's blessings. You see, it tells you something about Saul's character. You say, that seems like pretty harsh judgment. Yeah, I'll get used to it. That's the kind of judgment and the kind of obedience that God requires of His people, and especially His leaders. And so when Saul screwed up this time, now, they just won a big victory. They just beat off the Ammonites that were going to poke out the eyes of all the people down at Jabesh Gilead. He had tasted victory. But he hadn't learned very much from it. Now, before you get all high and mighty about how weak Saul is, I want you to think about yourself. How many things in your life, how many times have you seen God come through for you? And then the next thing happens, and you start letting fear come in. Can I tell you? There's only one godly fear in the Scripture. That is the fear of the Lord. If you have the fear of the Lord, you will not fear anything else. If you do not have the fear of the Lord, the Bible says even the sound of a leaf being blown by wind will cause you to run in fear for your life. Fear is not from God, except the fear of the Lord that drives you to be committed to Him and to be obedient to Him. That's the fear of the Lord that He wants. And by the way, when you mature completely in your faith and, excuse me, when you mature completely in your love for the Lord, then the fear is diminished. Because the Bible says perfect love or mature or whole love casts out fear. Because fear has with it the idea of punishment, and that's only necessary when you're disobedient. So as our love matures, Jesus said, if you love me, how can I see it? By the way, you sing, oh, how I love Jesus. You knew that would have to come again, didn't you? See, I love Jesus more. I'm really loud. No. How much do you obey His guidelines for you? And when that love is perfected, fear has accomplished its purpose. The fear of the Lord is diminished because there's nothing to fear because you're honoring and pleasing Him in your life. See, that's what God's calling us to. But a selfish, fleshly, ungodly, self-centered, egotistical church in America today thinks it doesn't need God's fear while they walk, talk, and act like the devil and hold on to their bumper stickers that they've got their ticket punched and they're going to go to heaven because they went to church or because they took the sacrament or because they prayed a prayer or because they got baptized, because they spoke in tongues, whatever. Took the sacrament, oh, yeah, we're there. No. The measurement from God is the conduct in your relationship with your fellow man, your daily life. And that's why Jesus said, by their fruit, you're going to know them. Here Saul's been filled with the Spirit twice. He probably could have made it into some churches I'm not qualified for. Because I haven't jumped through the hoop. But Saul, man, he's filled with the Spirit. There's no doubt. He could have been a member of places I couldn't. And yet he was double-minded. And he let fear move in on him. He didn't recognize what it was to stand against it and to have confidence in God. And so, the judgment on him was, God was going to let you and your descendants be the kings over Israel. And it would endure, but he said, not so. It's interesting that he already said, God, the Lord, has sought out for himself a man after the... How did Samuel know? Because Saul just had done what had happened. How did Samuel know? And how is he able to say God has already found somebody else who has a heart after him in a way that you don't? There's only one way that Samuel could have known that. Word of knowledge by the Holy Spirit. He was told before all this happened, it's like Samuel's on his way to get there. We don't know what delayed him, but he said, I'll get there. on the seventh day, and the seventh day wasn't up yet. But Saul got panicked, and so while he's there, God's already saying, by the way, he's already given over to fear. He doesn't trust me. He won't obey me. That's not important to him. And by the way, Samuel, I've selected someone else who's going to take his place, who has a kind of heart that I want. But now your kingdom shall not endure, in verse 14. And Samuel, verse 15, rose, went from Gilgal to Gibeah of Benjamin. And Saul numbered the people who were present with him, about 600 men. And Saul and his son Jonathan and the people who were present with him were staying in Gibeah. So the raiders came from the camp of the Philistines in verse 17 in three companies. One company turned toward Ophrah and the land of Shaul, and another company toward Beth Horon, and another company toward the border, out toward the wilderness. And see, verse 19 says, now no blacksmith could be found in all the land of Israel, for the Philistines had said, lest they make swords or spears. So all Israel went down to the Philistines to have even their plows sharpened, their mattocks, their axe, their hoe, and everything. And the charge was 2/3 of a shekel. And he even tells the price, the going price, that they could charge him because they weren't allowed to have blacksmith. So it came about on the day of battle, neither sword nor spear was found in the hand of any of the people who were Saul and Jonathan. But they were only with, they only had two swords. 600 men had two swords, Saul's and Jonathan's. So they're in a heap of trouble here, you know. They got 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, besides the foot soldiers. And they've got two swords. The deck is stacked.
Plus the horses pulling the chariots.
Plus the horses pulling the chariots, yes. That'd have to be 30,000 of the horses, plus another 6,000 horsemen. Now, folks, that's what you call outnumbered. Except for one thing. They had God with them. So it didn't matter. They could amass all the weapons of war and all the trained soldiers that they could find. They would not hold a candle to what the Lord is going to do, which leads into the most interesting thing which occurs next. So here they are with two swords. And here's Saul. He's under the pomegranate tree. That's a good place to be. Get a little shade, you know, trying to figure out what they're going to do. And in verse 6, this is what transpires. Jonathan said to the young man who was carrying his armor, come with me, let's cross over to the garrison of these uncircumcised. Now, what Jonathan was saying when he made that statement is much bigger than just saying they aren't Israelites. He was saying, we have the presence of God and the kingdom of God, His resources available to us. These people do not. They are outsiders. I'm telling you, the wisdom and insight that Jonathan had is just mind-boggling. Listen to what he says next. Perhaps the Lord will work for us. Listen to this. For the Lord is not restrained to save by many or by few. Now, you know, I could say amen. We could all stand and shout and say amen sitting here tonight. This very accommodating place here. Air-conditioned comfort here in the lake house. Oh yeah, God doesn't need big numbers. But you need to remember what's happening. They've got 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, thousands of soldiers, all of them armed, and Jonathan and Saul, with their 600 men, they have two swords. I don't know if the other guys brought their pitchforks. Those do look a little scary. But they don't really stand up. If you got a choice of a sword or a pitchfork in a fight, well, I guess it depends on what you're accustomed to. Maybe if you've done more using of a hay fork or a pitchfork, maybe that's what you'd rather have. But look at the wisdom that Jonathan had. God's not restrained to save by many or few. So his armor bearer said to him, do all that's in your heart. Most guys would look at him and say, are you nuts? They've got 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, thousands of soldiers. We've got two swords. You want to go take them on? But you see, there was something that his armor bearer saw in his heart. And he said, if you want to cross over to their outpost over here, I'm with you. He said, do what's in your heart. And in verse 8, Jonathan said, behold, we'll cross over to the men and reveal ourselves to them. And if they say to us, wait till we come to you, then we'll stay in our place and not go up. But if they say, come up to us, because it was up the mountain. See, they had gotten the higher ground where they could survey the land and send signals down to the army down below about where their enemy was. But he said, if they say, come up to us, then we'll go up, for the Lord has given men into our hands, and this will be assigned to us. He essentially is putting out a fleece. He's saying, I know that God doesn't need big numbers to win. I just don't know if he's telling us to go on and take on these people. Now you need to remember, it's not in the confines of the lake house. This is out on the battlefield. He can see the dust. He can see the crowds. He can see the glistening of their weapons. And they had two swords. This is a guy who really had confidence in God. I am envious of the confidence and the faith that Jonathan had at this point. And how did he have that? He got it from the Scripture. He got it by the Spirit of God. He got it by learning the history of what God had done in the past for the descendants of Israel. And so, verse 11, they revealed themselves to the garrison of the Philistines, and they said, behold, Hebrews are coming out of the holes where they've hidden. And verse 12, so the men of the garrison hailed Jonathan and his armor bearer, saying, hey, come up to us, we want to tell you something. Yeah. Get real close, because we want to chop your head off. Okay. So they thought, you know, there were a dozen or 15 of them, and just these two guys with one little sword. And so then Jonathan said in verse 12 to his armor bearer, come up after me, for the Lord has given them into the hands of Israel. And Jonathan climbed up on his hand. By the way, if you're climbing from below, you're climbing up, you're at a huge disadvantage. This is not the right military tactics. He would have flunked out of the tactics of taking a garrison on a hilltop in the military academy. That's not how you do it. But here he goes up the side of the hill because he knew that God had given him the sign that God was going to be with him. So he's on his hands and he's going up. He's up the side of the hill, and he climbed up on his hands, and it didn't say knees, it says feet, with his armor bearer behind him, and they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer put some of them to death after him. And by the way, how would the armor bearer do it? Because there was only one sword. Jonathan had injured them. He took their own swords and finished them off, put them out of their pain and suffering. And so it says that verse 14, the first slaughter which Jonathan and his armor bearer made was about 20. I thought I was thinking it was 15. 20 men. Within about half a furrow in an acre of land. And there was trembling in the camp and in the field among the people, even the garrison and raiders trembled, and the earth quaked so that it became a great trembling. Now Saul's watchmen in Gibeah, Benjamin, verse 16, they look down and the multitude's melting away. They're looking from a long distance and they're seeing that it's starting to melt away like ice melting. What's going on? How come their army is running away? And Saul said to the people with him, number now and see who's gone from us. And when they numbered, behold, Jonathan and his armor bearer were not there. And he said to Ahijah, bring the ark of God, for the ark of the Lord was with the sons of Israel at that time. And it happened while Saul talked to the priest that the commotion in the camp of the Philistines continued and increased. So Saul said to the priest, withdraw your hand. And Saul and all the people who were with him rallied and came to the battle. And behold, every man's sword was against his fellow, and there was great confusion. Now the Hebrews, who were with the Philistines previously, who went up all around them in the camp, they turned to be with the Israelites who were with Saul and Jonathan. When all the men of Israel had hidden themselves in the hill country of Ephraim, heard the Philistines had fled, even they pursued them closely in battle. So the Lord delivered Israel that day, and the battle spread beyond Bethel. Now why have I read extensively from this? I want you to understand, these are real life crises and circumstances that they're dealing with. I don't expect that any of you are concerned tonight about the Philistines attacking your house. But you know what? There are other issues very much like that. Where is your confidence in God about what the Lord's going to do about these things? Hasn't He delivered you in the past? Aren't you willing to trust him even in the unknown? Jonathan was willing to take on 30,000 chariots and 6,000. God's not asking you to take on 30,000 chariots. It might be you might have to take on a lawyer if you've got a legal problem. You might have to take on a neighbor if you've got a dispute or something going on. You may have some kind of a problem in the family. You may have a problem in a business deal that's not going right. You may just have a problem with your health that you're dealing with. And those things all can be very much like the Philistines. Are you going to trust the Lord? Or aren't you? Hasn't God come through for you before? Well, I'm just not really sure that's what God wants. Well, let me remind you. Jonathan didn't know either. He put out a fleece. He said, okay, we're gonna stand up and show where we are. And if they say, oh, we're going to come down to you. Well, no, God said, no, I'm not doing anything right now. But if they say, come up, we know that God's going to give us the victory. And he takes off there with his one sword, takes on 25 men who were well armed and well trained. And the Lord was with them. And not only that, the 30,000 chariots take off and run, and the 6,000 horsemen do, and the thousands and thousands of other soldiers flee. Why? Because of one person who had confidence in God. Because of one. How about that? Because of one. See, when the Scripture talks about the victory that God gives us over the enemy, the powers of darkness and their plan of destruction for you and for your family and for your body and for your relationships, be aware that one devoted person can put 10,000 to flight. When the Scripture says that, that's not just blowing smoke. That really happened, and we have it illustrated and described for us right here in Samuel. Now, I know that we're looking at Saul, but this is his son. What do you think Saul's response should be at this point? He's already screwed up. Yeah. Son, what are you doing going out there? Well, apparently he didn't mind, He didn't have orders to do it except from God. It's a pretty good thing if you have orders from God to follow those. That's pretty good.
What about the armor bearer? Wouldn't he count as having...
Well, he had that confidence.
So there would be two, Jonathan and the armor bearer.
And they put 36,000 horses to flight, the chariots and the horsemen. Besides thousands and thousands of soldiers like the sands of the sea. God did that. And it started with one man having confidence in him. So I don't know what the Philistines are in your life, but I just want to tell you that God's already given you the victory. Unless you want to cower back and tremble in fear and maybe outsource to somebody else, to give it to one of the experts. I'm not smart enough to figure this out. Oh, yes, you are. If you trust in the Lord and listen for His voice, He will give you the victory over whatever the camp of the Philistines is doing to you. I want to jump down to chapter 15. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, it tells us that Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you as king over the people over Israel. Now therefore listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he set himself against him on the way when he was coming from Egypt. And go now, and if you don't recall what the Amalekites did, as they were coming across the desert, hundreds of thousands of them, the Amalekites would strike at the stragglers in the back, those who were infirm or sick or elderly or the young that couldn't move as quickly. They would come in and steal from them, and in some cases take them as slaves. And God says, okay, my patience with them is over. Now it's time for judgment. And that's what he's talking about here in verse 3. Now go and strike Amalek and utterly destroy all he has. Do not spare him, but put to death both man, woman, child, infant, oxen, sheep, camels, donkeys, everything. This is about the most severe judgment that you will find God meting out against the enemies, because it was despicable what they were doing, preying on the weak and the infirm and young, and taking advantage of their circumstances being out in the desert there. Then Saul summoned the people and numbered them, and there were 200 foot soldiers and 10,000 men. And he came to the city of Amalek and set an ambush. And so he gives out the directions, and he said, tell these, where is it here in verse 6? Tell the Kenites, go depart, go from the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. For you showed kindness to the sons of Israel when you came from Egypt. So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. Saul gave them a warning, said, you guys get out of there. We've got a job to do against these enemies. So Saul defeated the Amalekites from Halbalah. You go to Shur, which is east of Egypt, and he captured Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and utter destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. And Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, the lambs, and all that was good, and were not willing to destroy them utterly, but everything despised and worthless, that they utterly destroyed. So, what did God told them to do? Destroy everything. What did they do? They destroyed what they didn't like. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, listen to this, what God says. I regret that I've made Saul king, for he's turned back from following me. He's not carried out my commands. Samuel was distressed. Well, you know, he just didn't have a bad day. Look what it says. He cried out to the Lord all night about Saul. He was heartbroken over King Saul. I don't know how many of you have had a traumatic experience happen and someone has stayed with you all night. This is really what Samuel was doing here, showing the love that he had for Saul. He cried out to the Lord all night. And Samuel arose early in the morning and met Saul, and it was told Saul, Samuel saying, Saul came to Carmel. Listen to this. Behold, he set up a monument for himself, and he turned and proceeded down to Gilgal. Wow. Here's the guy that not so many months before was so humble that he's with the baggage. He wouldn't even come out in public until they drug him out. Now he's building monuments for himself. Reminds you of any people in America today building monuments for themselves? Now, but see, he started out very humble, but look what's happened to him. Instead of giving the glory and the credit to God for the good things that have been happening, and even for what God did through his son Jonathan's action, no action of his own, he should have been on his face before God in gratitude. But instead, he started taking the credit for himself and even builds himself a monument. And Samuel came to Saul and said, blessed are you of the Lord, I've carried out the command of the Lord. You know, if you shout loud enough when you're lying, maybe people will believe it. Oh, Samuel, it's wonderful, I've done the command of the Lord. You lying turkey. And you notice that the prophet, being a real prophet of God, was not buffaloed by that at all. He saw right through the smoke screen that Samuel, that Saul was putting out in Samuel's direction. And Samuel said in verse 14, what then is the bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of oxen which I hear? He called him on his line. I've done the command of the Lord. How come I'm hearing sheep? The bleating of the sheep and the lowing of the oxen. Listen to this quick tap dance. Oh, he said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God. We're just taking them as an offering to church. Come on, Samuel, you can't object to that, can you? Did the people spare him to bring as a sacrifice to God? No, they didn't. He's lying again. You can't object, can you? There are sacrifices for God, but the rest we have utterly destroyed. And Samuel said to Saul, wait, let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night. And then he said, speak. I have a feeling it wasn't, I've done the command of the Lord, speak. I have a feeling it was more like the kid who's been busted by his parents. Speak. Sit down here and listen. Tell me. Is it not true that though you were little in your own eyes, you were made head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed you king over Israel, and the Lord sent you on a mission and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they're exterminated. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord, but rushed upon the spoil and did what was evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said to Samuel, I did obey the voice of the Lord. Now he wants to argue with him. I did obey. No, he didn't. Now I want you to notice what this reveals about King Saul's heart. His heart was perverted. His heart was distorted. But wait a minute. Wasn't he filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesying? Wasn't he filled with the Holy Spirit and given direction on how, out of anger, he demanded that the people come to the rescue of their brethren? And here he is. First, denying that he did anything wrong and even arguing with Samuel. Now I want you to contrast that, and we'll look and explore this a little further later. When Nathan the prophet was sent in to David after his sin with Bathsheba and abandoning Uriah and actually arranging his death to cover up his sin with his wife, when Nathan the prophet comes in and he tells the parable, and David, it's like he was so enraged, he stood up and said, whoever did this deserves to die. And the prophet said, you're the man who did this, king. Do you remember what David's response was? How dare you come into the palace of the king? No, no, no. You know what David's response was? He fell on his face in repentance before God and he cried out and said, oh God, I have sinned. In fact, you know what David said about his sin? He said, against you, O Lord, against you only, O Lord, have I sinned and done what's evil in your sight. Well, what about Uriah? You arranged to have his life taken. You took his wife. She's pregnant with your kid. But you see, David began to understand the consequence of sin. The consequence of the sin was, David said, against you only, O Lord, have I sinned and done what's evil in your sight. He understood what it meant to be a sinner. That God is primarily the one offended when we choose to rebel, to disobey, and to sin against Him. You see, Samuel is a religious man. He just oversaw a blessing and a sacrifice because he got fearful that all the people would leave. He's a very religious man. He's even filled with the Spirit and prophesying. Surely he is a good, upstanding church member. He's got to be saved and going to heaven. But look what he does. It reveals what's in his heart. He lies. He says, I did do what God said. Verse 20. I went on the mission which the Lord sent me on, and we brought back Agag, king of Amalek. Even that, hello, while he's saying, I did what God said. God said, kill them all. Destroy them all. This is my judgment for what they did to you when you were weak and vulnerable. But then he says, verse 21, but the people took some of the spoil, the sheep and oxen, the choicest things devoted to destruction, to sacrifice to the Lord your God at Gilgal. And here again we have Samuel making one of those monumental statements of truth in Scripture that everyone should know. Has the Lord as much delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of divination. He's saying rebellion is just like witchcraft in God's eyes. And insubordination is as iniquity and idolatry. And because you've rejected the word of the Lord, He has also rejected you from being king. Now even Saul speaks some truth. I have sinned. I have indeed transgressed the command of the Lord in your words, and here's the motive. He tells some truth. Are you ready? Because I feared the people and listened to their voice. Wow. Across America today, there are millions who influence their leaders in their churches, and leaders do what their church wants them to do. That's their primary concern, instead of speaking the truth from God. You see that repeated over and over and over again. I feared the people, listened to their voice. Now therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may worship the Lord. And Samuel said, I will not return with you, for you've rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you from being king. And as he turned to go, Paul seized the edge of his robe and it tore. And Samuel said to him, the Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to your neighbor who is better than you. Wow. When did David become king of Israel? It's a long time after Saul dies. Which, by the way, he winds up taking his own life. Pretty miserable circumstance. But I want you to see when, in God's view, when David became king. David became king right here in this verse. The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to your neighbor who is better than you. And shortly after that, Samuel goes and anoints David as king. Now, what would have been the appropriate response for King Saul at this point? Because you know what he winds up doing. He tenaciously tries to hold on to the kingdom. Even though he's already been told God selected a different king. What would have been the right response if his hearts had been right? He said, I'm not worthy of this position anymore. Please bring the new king and I will be his faithful servant. But he couldn't do that. You know why he couldn't do it? He was so full of himself. That's exactly it. He was so proud about who he was. He just built a monument to himself. And so a number of years pass, and things get worse and worse and worse for Saul. And we're going to look at a few of those things and probably wrap up our investigation of Saul next week. But I want to ask you, does this help any with your discernment? Jonathan had discernment in trusting in God. But can you see how a heart that is not fully turned to God winds up being double-minded? He's with the prophets. He's filled with the Spirit. He's doing the work of God. He's being guided by God. But he operates out of fear and lets fear control him. And he winds up sinning against God. And then the next thing you know, he fears the people. He was fearful that they would leave and have to fight the enemies with fewer people. Now he's afraid of the people instead of standing up saying, no, this is the way. This is what God said to do. We're not taking any of these things back to sacrifice. God said it's time for judgment on these people. Did you see he failed as a leader? And it revealed what was in his heart. And his heart was full of himself and not totally devoted. Yes, ma'am.
You see the similarities between Saul and Lucifer?
That's true. Yeah. And of course, Saul wasn't really aware, but he was under the influence of Satan and the powers of darkness. In fact, next week we're going to read specifically some very disturbing passages about the influence of Satan in King Saul's life, which is always the case for a man who is double-minded, who's unstable in all his ways, who's not totally devoted to God. And yet he's religious. He's filled with the Spirit. He has moments when he's in tune with God. But that, you see, do you notice that doesn't give him a free pass? That now it doesn't matter what he does, you know. He's gonna be blessed by God regardless of what he does. No, he's gonna be blessed according to his obedience to the Lord. Sharon, you have a thought?
Yeah. In 2 Samuel, when Saul died, and the man that came up to David was an Amalekite.
An Amalekite? Another Amalekite.
There was another one. So he didn't kill them all. He was supposed to be.
He was supposed to destroy them all? That's right.
He was alive, but there was more.
So it's an Amalekite who winds up putting the sword through King Saul.
Isn't that interesting?
I've never seen it. We'll look at that a little bit further.
Yeah, wait. It's 2 Samuel 1:8.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm.
Isn't this like the Achan story?
Very much so. Mm-hmm. Where they took the things, and he brought judgment. Achan brought judgment on his entire family. And because he sinned, 36 households lost the men, the heads of their household, because of Achan's sin. And Achan was brought out, and his wife and his children and their animals and everything they had, and they stoned them to death and they burned them with fire. You say, well, gosh,
that's pretty harsh.
That's pretty harsh. Yeah, but there are 36 families whose husbands died because of their sin. And that was a consequence for their sin.
I think we have a problem.
Yeah.
For judgment.
Right. You know,
in our eyes,
and that's really for the last 50 years, the American churches have not wanted to talk about the righteousness and holiness of God. Now, you say, well, I heard a church that did. Exactly. You see, the exception proves exactly what I'm saying, that on the whole, the American churches only want to talk about God being a God of love, and it's a good thing that He is. Otherwise, we'd all be gone, okay? So He is a God of love, but He is equally a God of righteousness and holiness that demands judgment. And that's some of what we're seeing about His character and nature.
And His wrath.
He says,
wrath.
Justice is mine, saith the Lord.
That's right. God's going to have the final say about
And those instances were because there had been deaths that should not have been.
That's correct.
They decimate. So then, and then the other thing is they wiped out the whole family and his oxen and grasses
right.
and everybody. But the other thing with that is too that God also says, if you sin, I will punish you into the third and fourth
That's
generation.
Correct.
And in eliminating these people, then you didn't have this crazy murdering somebody else.
See, that's a great insight, because God said this wickedness and evil that they've been passing down generation to generation ends here. It stops now. That's what you're beginning to get some insight into, why God is so harsh about some of the judgment that we see in the Scripture.
Do you see the wrath of God coming down today?
No. You mean today specifically, or you just mean in our time now?
Yeah.
But see, most American Christians are blind to it because they have this distorted view of God, who is pretty much like the Santa Claus in the sky, or maybe the big genie in the sky that's supposed to hop to and fix things for us. And folks, that's not the God of this book. We need to get to know the real God if we want to know truth. Two very powerful scriptures that we saw tonight. Far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you. And does the Lord have as much delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. God grant us tonight the discernment to begin to understand that what you really desire from us is our heart. And where our hearts are is going to be revealed in the pressure and the squeezing of the trials and difficulties that we face in life. God, may our hearts be pure, purely devoted to you. And Lord, we know what you require. And tragically, Saul missed it. He had the great opportunity. But Lord, what you require is for us to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you. But we need to do all of those things in the power of your Spirit and by the power of your presence in our lives, Lord. I thank you tonight for us seeing this tragedy played out on the pages of the Scripture. And may we realize that Saul is a man, as human as anyone would meet, as human as we've ever been. But Lord, that you give us the opportunity to overcome that double-mindedness and that fear and the worry about the Philistines. And you grant us victory, and yet in the victory, Lord, we need to be on guard that we walk humbly with you and recognize that all the credit and all the glory goes to you. We bless you for that tonight, in Jesus' name.